Greetings, my name is Seth Eckert, and today we're going to be talking about this spinning image display I've kind of set up for you. It's good for video, animations, images, could even be used as a transition from one thing of content to the next. We're going to be looking at parenting these images to null objects, or a null object, to help drive our animation and make things a little easier for us, and then also using some simple expressions to help us out. So let's go ahead and take a look at what we're going to do here today. So first thing you want to do is, in After Effects, you're going to want to add a new composition. I'm going to name this Spinning Tutorial. And first thing you're going to want to do is, you know, obviously add a background object. I'm going to throw a ramp on there just to give it a little bit of some fall off, I guess. Make it look like it's kind of, you know, like the sun's almost like hitting the top here. It's a good idea never to have pure white or pure black. But we're going to make this a little bit of bluish gray and then a yellowish white. Good background to start with. A little bit of a scatter and then blend with the original a little bit. First thing you're going to want to do is drop in your first four images. Once you've got these images in there, we're going to make them 3D layers. Once we have those 3D layers in, we're going to want to add a null object by going Layer, New, Null Object. What we're going to name this null object is Image Controller. And we're also going to make that a 3D layer. So now if you look in your viewport, if you go to two views horizontal, you can kind of see the top view or whatever view you have selected here. I like to default to top because I can see a little bit of a different perspective since I already have the front here. You'll see that I have my four images and my null object all sitting here in Z space. What you're going to want to do first is I'm going to parent by selecting the parent drop down menu. I'm going to parent these to the image controller. Now what that has done is it zeroed out all of my positions and rotations, and then the control has now been given over to this null object. So if you see I rotate this here, here, you know, all my images are kind of moving with that. That's not what we want, so we'll reset that. So now we need to offset all these. Now to do that, I'm going to start with image one. I'm going to pull that towards the camera by going to negative 1000. Image two, I'm going to hit to the left 1000, so negative 1000, and the X parameter. Three is going to be back in Z space, so throw that back 1000. Then image four, we're going to go to the right 1000. So now I've got these kind of offset here from the middle at the exact same distance. So if I start rotating this, you can see they're all rotating and matching the null's rotation. But they're not really framed very well, so what we're going to do now is go to Layer, New, Camera. With this new camera, what we can do is if we go back to our two views, can take that, if I can select the Z here, and pull that back, now everything's framed a little bit more nicely. So what we're going to do here is we're going to start our animation by just the image controller. So I'm going to start at 1 second at, you know, zero, and then we go negative 90 for that first turn. Then we're going to go to two, hit keyframe, go to three, 90, four, keyframe, five. A good thing that you can do sometimes if you can't add the two numbers together, 90 plus 90 is 180, but if you do the math actually inside this box, it'll actually output that number for you, which is real handy if you're dealing with very crazy numbers, which I have sometimes. So we're going to continually do this down the timeline until we get back to 360, which should be in 9 seconds. Could have hit one there too. So now we have our controller animation complete here. But what we're going to want to do is smooth that out a little bit, as it's pretty rigid right now. So I'm going to select all the moving keyframes, which would be every other one. And you can hit F9 to add an easy ease to these, or you can go into your timeline graph, hit easy ease, and then I like to take all of my ease ins and make them to the extreme. That way it's a little bit more of a smooth animation, as you can see here. So now the issue we are running into is the images are all turning in ways that we do not want them to. So what we can do here is, what I want to do is for the first image, I want it to stay looking forward. So right now it's following the rotation of the null since that's what it's parented to. So if I alt click on the Y rotation stopwatch, which adds an expression, I can take the pick whip from that and reference the rotation of the image controller. And what that has done is actually doubled my rotation, basically. So now that instead of going 90, it's going 180, which we can be cool if you want to do that, but that's not what we're trying to do here. We want them all to be looking forward. So what I can do there is put parentheses on around the front and end of that expression and hit multiply -1. And what that does is it makes it sit forward the whole time. So when this is 90, this is -90, 180, -80, if that makes sense. As you can see here, see this is -155 and this is 155. So now I want that to happen to all of these images. So I can just hit Control C on the Y expression and Alt click on each of these stopwatches for the Y rotation on each of the images and just hit paste, just Control V. So now I have all my images facing forward, which is really nice. But now it looks like they're a little flat. Looks like they're not very coming too close in that Z space. So what we're going to want to do is we're going to want to scale up these images. And as long as you're not scaling too far beyond the width of your frame, if your images are large enough, you should be okay with them not being too pixelated. But it's always a good idea to have your image or composition at least match that of the size of yours if you're going to scale it up pretty big. So what we're going to do is hit S, and then for the image control, I'm going to hit U. And that'll show me all the keyframes for that rotation. So image one, we want that to be scaled at 200. It's just a good even number to pick there. I'm gonna go back to its original position and make it back to 100. So now as it comes up, scales up. But we want that, the curve of that animation to match what I have in the timeline here. So we are going to make that the same by going to the graph editor, and that's what we want. So I'm gonna go to 2, hit keyframe. If you control click on that eased in keyframe, it'll flatten it out again to linear. And then I'm going to make this back down to 100. And again, I need to go back into my graph editor. So now it scales up, scales down, back into place. So I can take this scale animation and I can copy it. And that's a real easy way to get these images kind of rolling. So I'll go to image 4 since that's the next one up in the line. That one scale up, go to 4 seconds, the next one coming up will be 3, and then go to 6, and that's when that next image will come up, and then the first image comes back, and I'll paste that there. But I'm gonna, for tutorial sake, if you want to keep this going, you can have the scale back in if that's the end of your work or whatever you want there. But I'm gonna cut those keyframes and actually throw them on this image that we have up first. That way it's kind of a fluid animation all around. So now I've got all my content kind of flying around here, but what I want to do is I want to have, you know, these images change as they come up. I don't want them to be the same images going around. So what you can do is this first image, which I actually have as image 2. You might want to have these in better numerical order, at least in a more fluid way here, but just for this tutorial's sake, what you can do is have this image, as it goes behind all these other images, is not visible anymore. I want this to switch to a new image. So I can pre-compose that by hitting Control-Shift-C, or if you're on a Mac, Command-Shift-C. We're gonna aim this image pre-composition number 2. And the good thing is, if you are just pre-composing one layer, I keep all of my animation here, which is nice. If you do more than one, you're going to lose a little bit of that, but it's easy to get back. So what I'm going to do is, if I double click on this pre-comp in the timeline where I want that switch in image to happen, I'll drop in image 5 here so I have another image. And if I hit the left bracket, it'll snap that image to that 3 seconds in the timeline. So here it's the iguana goes back, and then right about 3 seconds it's switching to that alligator, comes up, and now this alligator back up in front. Real nice way to keep images flowing, and you can do that to all of these. Just pre-compose each of these, and you're going to save each of them, and you can switch them out each time. That's probably a good idea to name those, but just for example, that's what you can do there. So now that I have this animation kind of going the way I want, and I have all my images in there, another couple things you can add a shadow underneath of here, which looks pretty cool. So once you have all this stuff, good idea would be pre-compose all of your elements except for the background. So Control-Shift-C, let's say all elements. So now that I have this pre-composed, it's no longer a 3D layer. What I can do is I can duplicate that layer. I'm going to make the bottom one 3D, and I'm going to scale this by just grabbing the top, moving it down, and then just selecting it and moving it down. Now you see it's kind of sitting there at the bottom and it looks a little funky. But what this is going to be is ultimately the shadow. But by duplicating that, I have an exact replica of that original composition, so I can use that as an exact shadow. So what I can do here is I can go to the effects presence and type in tent, select my tent, add it to that bottom layer. I'm just going to take this little eyedropper and make it black so everything's black. So that's a pretty ugly shadow. So what I want to do now is go to fast blur in the effects panel, drag fast blur onto that, and you can make this, something like 150, whatever you think looks best. But then it's a little dark, so we'll just go into the opacity by hitting T, make this like 25, and there we go. I've got a really nice shadow. I want to make it even a little more blurred, a little less. Nice shadow kind of rolling. This is a real nice way to show off your images. Another great way that you can even make this a transition to start. So you have video. Say I want this first image. This first image in this all elements composition to be full frame. You can start this at full frame at first. Take all of my stuff, move it down 1 second. Actually, let's not do that. But full frame, so say I'm coming out of a video, got a video playing, then transition out as to a slideshow, and this is how it's happening. That could be a really, really great use for this as a transition. So anyway, what we've learned here is we've learned that we can parent objects to a null object and have the null object be what drives our animation, which makes it much easier on us than adding all those keyframes and offsetting the position and all that for us. We've learned that we can use some simple expressions to kind of offset the rotation if you have it parented to a null. And we've seen how this can be used for video animations and even transitions if that's something you wish to do. But I hope this tutorial turned out to be really helpful for you guys and you learned some tricks or something new that you can use in your projects, or even maybe something that might help speed up your workflow a little bit. Wish you good luck and good learning.